Good evening and welcome to another episode of Stories from the Northeast with me, your host, Durba Dhyani. Now, our fellow human beings are going through a lot of suffering, a very, very difficult time because of the COVID situation and the associated lockdown. So who would even have the time to spare a thought for animals is what we would think. But somebody does, and this somebody cares very deeply, very passionately. She is none other than Nandini Barua. Very happy to have her here with us. And apart from being a passionate animal rights activist, she's also a fashion designer. She has her own company called Kirameki, and she has her own line of women's clothing called Musings. So here she is to tell us more about her fashion line, but also more importantly, the cause that is very close to her heart, that of animal rights.
So Nandini, I'd like to start with your work as a fashion designer. So tell us about your company, Kirameki, and...
So I was always fascinated with designing, and my journey started from Pearl Academy of Fashion, New Delhi, where I did a three-year course in fashion retail. And after that, I worked for a couple of designers in Delhi, Anju Modi being one of them. And after a few years, few months rather, of working there, I thought, you know, it's time to come back to my roots and start my own label. Since then, this was in 2002, and it's been on since 2002. It's been a long time, basically. And since then, I've been doing women's wear mostly. But I've also recently started doing menswear.
Okay, and, so what led you to start menswear when you were already, you know, doing women's wear?
It's kind of funny because when the women come with their husbands, they would want to, you know, they also want to ask me that, you know, so what is there for the men folk?
Okay.
And there is not much, there's not much designer wear in Guwahati for men. And I thought that there's quite a prospective market for menswear. And I started off doing customized menswear. So basically on order. And now that I have started a new store, Musings, which is a concept store. A concept store meaning it's not just garments. It could probably have a lot of other things. There could be art. There could be, you know, there could be food. There could be pet accessories. Lot many things, and the scope is wider, but and also menswear. So I would introduce menswear as a collective feature in my new store Musings. So I think I should start one of those, and vegan food. I promote a lot of health conscious plant food. So maybe a small kiosk which would cater to healthy eating.
Yeah. Do you think it's difficult, Nandini, for somebody who wants to go vegan to find that kind of food? Or do you think in India, that's not a problem? Like anybody can become vegan if they want to?
Yes. See, Assamese food is predominantly vegan. We don't know. It's just that we don't know about it. The kind of greens we have, the kind of curries we have, they actually do not have a dairy base. They do not have a dairy base. And they are all plant-based. So I don't know if you know about khar, osala, khar, hak, you know, these kind of things.
If so you can just explain a little bit, Nandini, about the khar.
It is basically a staple Assamese dish, which is made up of different vegetables like papaya, gourd, and a lot of other vegetables, sometimes chickpeas. Coconut, and it is predominantly vegan in nature because there is no dairy involved. It's not a non-vegetarian dish. Then there is kaldil, which we say it's a kind of banana, but it is also very rich in iron. And the stuff we make out of this particular vegetable is completely vegan again. Then there is the tenga, the staple tenga that we say, you know. So we make bamboo shoot tenga, I have started making tenga with poppy seed dumplings. So poppy seed, you can mash, you can make small dumplings out of it, and you can put it in place of fish. Like normally what fish tenga. So instead of the fish, we put the poppy seed dumplings and we add bamboo shoot. So it is as tasty, it is as healthy as it can get, and it is vegan. So there's a lot of options.
Sounds fascinating and something that I didn't know about.
Yeah.
So there are all these dishes that have to be discovered yet. But do you think, Nandini, it's easy for somebody who's always had a meat-based diet, let's say, you know, who's been a non-vegetarian for many years, to turn vegan? It is difficult.
Mm-hmm. It is difficult. There are two reasons why people actually make the shift. One is for health reasons and on doctor's prescription. So that is one way of looking at it. And the other way is, of course, compassion. You know, where you understand that, you know, it's not ethical enough. So we make the shift. Now, the first one is a little difficult because then you kind of tend to go back. And when it comes to compassion, when you actually realize and there's a self-realization that comes, then I think it is much easier to leave. And I would suggest, you know, somebody who, like I was a non-vegetarian, I took it slow. So basically cut down and then slowly, gradually kind of get into the process. At one go, it doesn't, it won't really work. Either you come back or you might think that, okay, I'm missing out on things. So slowly and gradually. And also at the same time, improve your knowledge in what kind of plant-based options that we could indulge in. And there are a lot, trust me, nowadays. I mean, the market is full of it. And I think even in the West, the whole vegan culture is coming up very forcefully. And a lot of doctors, the medical associations, they also support the diet.
So it's not just healthy, but also for compassionate reasons. And speaking of compassion, Nandini, you know, I know how much you love and adore animals and that you are a very, very passionate animal rights activist. So how did you move from the glamorous world of fashion? And you haven't moved, you're still a fashion designer primarily. But along with that, the not so glamorous world of, you know, rescuing animals that have been abused, for example. How did that happen? Was there a point in your life where you felt the shift?
Well, yes. It's been like, 2001 I had started my design, and it's been just 5 years that I have started rescuing animals, and, you know, my NGO came into being. So this one incident that happened, I'm a cat person, you know, I've got this badge as well, you know, I love cats, cats make me happy. So I never touched a cat in my life. And there was this little kitten, suddenly I see in my compound, and it was dragging itself, and it was a rainy day, and it was completely soaked. And the baby was walking and trying to drag himself or herself. At that time, I did not know, but he turned out to be a boy. So the little one, we picked him up, and, you know, I picked him up actually. And then by reflex, you know, it just happened impulsively. So, and then we ran to the veterinary in Guwahati. There's a veterinary. So we went there, and we got to know, we had no idea what happened. So we got to know that he had gone through extreme trauma, and there was some force that had, you know, made him paralyzed, hip down paralysis. So if there are multiple fractures, then he can't get up for life. This is what they told me. And in fact, they told me that, why don't you go ahead and euthanize him immediately? Like in 10 minutes, they gave me that decision. Now, I had no idea what to do with that cat and how, what, you know, but I just told them, let's see if you can help me with him, just do that. You know, I'm not going to take that decision of, you know, putting him to sleep. So I was a little kind of, I didn't like it that they said that. That was not an option for me, you know. So I wanted to try. And then I went to another place, another veterinary, and they told me that let's try, you know, which is a very positive thing. And they started with pushing injections, basically nerve injections, and certain other things like hydrotherapy, infrared therapy, ray therapy, massage. And
I'm surprised, Nandini, are all of these available in India? I mean, there is treatment for a paralyzed animal and such advanced treatment like laser therapy, hydrotherapy, and some of the other things you mentioned.
Infrared ray, that sounds very technical, but it's not. It's just a light. It's just a red ray light that we give on the paralyzed portion. And then hydrotherapy is basically making them to swim and, you know, get the muscles to kind of work and roll. And also a little bit of physiotherapy. Physiotherapy is required because then, you know, muscle waste happens when there's no movement. So just to keep it rolling. So we need to do a lot of physiotherapy. Also with multiple fractures, it's kind of impossible without a surgery to get them up. Because of which my cat, I named him Mustard. And he's like my son. He is my son, basically. Yeah.
So the same cat who's a doctor or a vet or somebody who had said that, you know, we have no hope for him. You have to euthanize him. He is Mustard and he's still with you.
He's still with me. He's 5 years old. And he's also won PETA India contest for cutest rescued cat alive. So he's the second runner.
Oh, my goodness. Fantastic. Yeah. And that contest is based on good looks. And he's won it for his looks.
It's based on good looks. It's also based on his story as to how he was rescued. So there were a lot of participants, more than 500 participants pan India. And there were two participants from Guwahati. And Mustard kind of, he came to the top 10 and top 3.
Amazing. So, you know, that's such a wonderful and heartwarming story. So in the entire country, he won the crown, so to say. It was a national level contest. And among all these 500 entrants, he was the winner. So it was a proud moment for you.
Absolutely.
Right. Okay, awesome. So when did you decide to make it a very serious work and you started this foundation Purpose and you decided to kind of launch yourself and give yourself to the protection of animals, including animals that have been abused?
Yes. So when Mustard started showing signs of improvement, so it was this, it's a feeling that comes to you, you know, okay, you can make a difference. So, and then what happened after Mustard, then there were other animals that needed help that I saw, that I came across, and I couldn't stop myself. The whole thought that comes to my mind, if I could save one, I can save the second, then I can save the third and the fourth, you know, and that it kept happening. And then I came across this dog. She was my first dog, Linda. Somebody tagged me on Facebook and said that, you know, if this girl can be rescued. So she was lying on a footpath, on the side of the footpath. She was basically a bag of bones and couldn't stand up on her own. It was a very bad state she was in. We were not even an NGO. We were just, you know, the individuals. So me and there was one more volunteer. So both of us kind of picked her up, put her in an auto, and we went to the vet. And the vet immediately started giving her drips and, you know, the works. And then we did a blood test and we found out that she had babesia, which is a blood parasite infection. She had multiple tumors, which are cancerous. And she has BG, which is, again, another disease. So all three were quite serious diseases and they needed to be tended to. separately. So we started stepwise, and you know, it took a long time for her to deal with each issue separately. And in 5 months, she recovered. She gained her muscle and strength and everything back, her weight back. And now she's a lovely girl. She's healthy, and you know, she stays with me. I mean, I because she's my first dog, so I had to keep her with me. And you know, basically, I adopted her.
So you said so first it was first it was Mustard. Now you have Linda. So each time you rescue a dog, a cat, any animal, do you adopt them, and do they become like a part of your family? Because that's impossible. I mean, I can't imagine. You would have probably gone on to rescue dozens of animals by now.
Yes, 5 years, it's been like non-stop rescuing. And because of which I still have almost 70 dogs and cats under my under the shelter of Purpose Foundation. So
70, that's a lot of dogs.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, dogs and cats together.
Dogs and cats, okay.
So, yeah. So
do you just rescue dogs and cats, Nandini? Or is Purpose only focused on rescuing dogs and cats?
Ideally, there are more cats and dogs around that needs help and on the streets. But also we have rescued goats, we've rescued pigs, we've rescued rabbits, we've rescued horses.
So now there's Mustard, there's Linda, there's Varsha. Do you name every animal that you rescue?
Each and everyone. Yes.
Each and everyone. My goodness.
All 70 of them has names. And it's a personal connect that I have. And, you know, I try to spend as much time as I can with each one of them. Mm-hmm. So, and I think that way, it's a mutual healing, you know. We all need healing. And they heal and we heal. So I think that the connection has to be there. It cannot be a product. I mean, I basically work with passion. Mm-hmm. So... Since the beginning of my rescues, every rescue has a name. Every rescue has to spend time with me, or I need to spend time with the rescue. I have employers, but I kind of like to micromanage things, which is also essential, which I have seen in this line of work. Because if I do not give my time and my energy into smooth running of my shelter or my NGO, then it really doesn't work mm-hmm. on one or two people or on employers. So I believe that this whole personal connect has to be there with them.
So you have and to with be the totally hands on. Right.
Completely hands on.
And when something like this happens, Nandini, where you tried so hard with Varsha and finally she did not make it. So probably this is just one of several such instances.
Yes.
Is it always heartbreaking, and how do you deal with that sorrow each time?
That is the flip side of animal welfare. Animal welfare activists are always more or less depressed, you know. So a lot of depression sets in.
Still keeps you going.
The ones that survive.
Right.
And you know, from a position where they can't get up. And then they are running from a position where they can't breathe, and they are kind of, you know, running away and playing and being healthy. So the whole transition, when I see that, you know, it's like this magical transition that happens. That I think keeps us going, you know. And so basically, it's not just sick that we rescue. We also rescue abandoned dogs. We also rescue abused dogs, dogs and cats. When I say dogs, also mean any other animal that we see who's been abused or who's been abandoned. We cover most of all these things, all these areas. And each and every dog that we rescue, when we see the change and when we see the happiness, when the tails wag and they become healthy and they want to live further, and all the affection that comes through, it's amazing. You know, the whole energy and the vibe is so amazing it's just something. It's like an elixir. It just keeps us going, you know. Okay, another one, next one, next one. So it's good. It's a good thing, you know. it's a very positive thing that happened. And I think I just want to put this quickly that, you know, during this lockdown, a lot of people have actually gone through depression and, you know, there's so many difficulties.
Oh, absolutely, Nandini. You know, like you mentioned, this is
the other way around. I think they have a major capacity to kind of put in the happy hormones, you know, onto us. And it really works. And I don't find a single moment or a single day to actually sit and brood over things because I have so much to do and so much to give and so much to take in, you know. So I think animals, for that matter, they're innocent and they're unconditional. And they kind of give you this whole positivity that I think every human should get, should experience. So a companion animal is very important. If people can afford a companion animal, they should go ahead and do that. And a companion animal need not be an animal they buy, you know, which is something I don't support anyways. I do not support breeding. So a companion animal can be an animal from a shelter. My shelter, for example, is full of recovered dogs and cats. And they are all looking for homes. Shelter is not a home. So you know, it's important that people should start understanding the importance of going to a shelter and picking up a shelter dog or a cat and giving them a home.
Okay, so speaking of that again, Nandini, why would you suggest that a person who wants to own a pet, especially like, you know, when somebody is perhaps lonely and depressed, like you said, it's a very good idea to get a companion, an animal companion, and they are the best, I think, better than humans. But why do you say that get one not from a breeder, but from a shelter? Can you explain why they should make this choice?
Yes. We all know that breeding is a highly cruel concept. You know, when with breeders, I don't know if you know about puppy mills. So puppy mills are these horrific places where there are the parents of these little dogs, puppies and kittens. So they are mostly kept in horrible condition because for a breeder, they are products end of the day. And there are so many breeder rejects. So once till the time they can produce kids, fine. And after that, once they are of no use, then they are abandoned. So there are many dogs that I had personally picked up, and there are so many other NGOs here who have, I would only talk for my city. It's happening all around India. If you, I'm sure you would know, every city, every place, every small, big place has this issue of breeder rejects. So if this was such a noble profession, there wouldn't be breeder rejects, number one. And these rejects are in terrible, terrible condition. They are basically completely spent. You know, there's not a little ounce of energy in them. You know, they suffer from so many diseases, and they become old, and you know, and they've probably faced so much of cruelty during their time of giving service that they get into depression. They do not have the zeal to bounce back to life. So most of these breeder rejects I have seen have lost the will to live. And it's a very, very difficult and sad thing that we experience. German Shepherds, Labradors, for that matter, a lot of these other breeds, you know, that are there, Spitz, so Pomeranians and all these breeds. So so many we've seen rejected breeds on the road. And it's then we pick them up, we get them, we give them treatment, we try to kind of give them enough love to show them that they are also, they are not products, but they are also, you know, a being who needs love and affection and a home. So we try to even give them a home eventually, a good home, you know, for adoption.
All these breeds that you mentioned, Nandini, do you see a tendency of people to go for breeds like that, you know, slightly exotic breeds? Maybe a German Shepherd or a Pomeranian, rather than an Indian, indigenous, you know, Indian breed.
Yes.
So what do you say to such people?
I would say please also adopt an Indian dog. And if you've already got a GSD, then you can also try and adopt an Indian dog, Indian breed. When it comes to Indian dogs are very low maintenance. They don't have many health issues. They also are completely in sync with our environment, with our weather conditions. And like I said, they're very low maintenance. They do not have that many issues, internal issues. And they have a very good, robust system, you know, so which is...
Absolutely. And as you said, Indian dogs, they are better acclimatized to our conditions. And are they also equally easy to domesticate? Are they equally loving and loyal?
Yes.
As any other breed?
Yes, I would say they are more affectionate than, you know, in my experience, I would say they are always willing to give a lot of love and affection. And they're very, very big on tail wags. Also, like I said, they do not have any issues with food. They can have rice and vegetables and, you know, survive. They can have rice and dal and survive. So like I said, they're very, very easy to maintain, which is very important. And they can also be very good companion pets. Also they learn, it's not that we can only train breed dogs. We cannot train Indian dogs. We can definitely train Indian dogs. And we have trained a few ourselves in my shelter. We've trained a few. So some of these dogs, you know, it depends on the temperament. They are a little different, temperamental, you know, differences. So that is when we train them and we've realized that they take commands as good as any other breed dog. So, I mean, end of the day, I think we are all Indians and we should, you know, come forward and adopt our Indian dogs. If we adopt enough Indian dogs, there would be less Indian dogs on the streets, because of which people say it's an issue that, okay, we have that many street dogs. It is a nuisance. You know, it is unsafe for our children. There's so many things that people say. So if we all adopt indie dogs, then there would not be any dogs on the streets. The streets would be safe. The streets would be, you know, for them. And it's not that it's not safe. Like I said, indie dogs are the most safest. But then again, I think adoption is the only way, and animal birth control is the other scientific way of trying to get the population in check. So I think in animal welfare, animal birth control is very important.
So, you know, that's a solution I had never thought of, that if everybody starts adopting Indian dogs, we would have less dogs on the streets, and then we wouldn't have to resort to some sort of cruel methods that are there to control the dog population.
Exactly. And there's two things that we need to do. One is animal birth control, other is adoption. If these two things happen simultaneously, our issue is solved for good. But that has not happened.
So it's just the will that's not there. The solution is right there, staring us.
Yes. I think a lot of Indian dogs have been sent abroad by a lot of NGOs from Delhi and Bombay, Calcutta. And a lot of these people from the West, they in US especially, they have adopted our indie dogs, and they have these lovely Instagram pages. They're very proud of their dogs, you know, the same dogs that are our Indian pariah dog, and the same dogs that our Indian people are ashamed to keep.
So I think that should be a real lesson for us, that the ones that we consider our pariah dogs and, you know, low grade compared to a German Shepherd or an Alaskan Husky. Yeah, doesn't have that status. That should be quite a slap on the face for us when we see these people from abroad who prefer Indian dogs rather than the other ones. And speaking of dogs again, Nandini, there's this whole issue of the dog meat trade issue that was recently in focus. And then certain states have also banned it now.
Nagaland has banned
dog meat trade. So what do you think of this, and were you involved in any way in trying to stop dog meat trade?
Yes, 2 years back, my organization has been involved in rescuing about 100 dogs in separate incidents. So all these dogs basically were kidnapped from the street or from homes of people. Some of them were pets, some of them were street dogs. They were tied with wires on their mouths, on their legs, and put in gunny bags, in sacks, and in completely dehydrated conditions. And so these people, these kidnappers, they have little hideouts, so where they kind of dump them from here and there. And then when they have enough, then they take them to either Mizoram, Nagaland, wherever they do this business. They sell a dog for, say, a meager rupees 500. So, you know, we say the dog is man's best friend, you know, and the poor dog doesn't even know he's going to be chopped in a bit. And the thing is, these people try to say this is in our culture. I mean, even headhunting was a culture at one point of time. We don't do that anymore, right? So,
perhaps this question may arise, Nandini, where people would say, what about all the other animals that are eaten for food, from chicken to mutton to pork? Why are you only after dog meat? What have we done wrong? What would be your response?
We have a constitution of India. So we have food specified as livestock in it. So these are the rules made by the, you know, constitution. It's not made by us, it's by the government of India. So in livestock, if you see what is mentioned there very categorically, it's chicken, goat, pig, you know, and the sorts that are allowed to be slaughtered. Also, not slaughtered on the road, they have to be slaughtered in a specific slaughterhouse, in a licensed slaughterhouse. What we see on the streets, you know, slaughtering here and there, that is actually illegal. Except we do not have accountability, we do not have people like the right people coming and stopping these things. So because of that, there is no, you know, I mean, the rules are not being followed. And anybody can basically slaughter an animal on the road. But according to rules, an animal which is a certified livestock can be only slaughtered in a slaughterhouse, in a humane way. So in that list, there is no dog, there is no cat mentioned. These are domestic animals, they're pet animals, they're companion animals. It's illegal by the PCA Act 1960, Prevention to Cruelty Act. There's a PCA Act 1960, which has all the guidelines for animals, for animal welfare of this country. According to that, it is illegal to basically slaughter companion animals and eat them. And I think Northeast is also very much a part of India. And probably they have forgotten that, you know, there is a constitution of India that also says it's illegal. And they try to say that it is our culture. But now, after heavy criticism from animal activists, PETA India has also played a huge role in this. Meneka Gandhi has been after this whole dog meat thing. And then innumerable organizations who've been working to stop dog meat trade, they've been rescuing. It's not just me. I mean, I'm just this one small fish in the pod. So, but then there are so many organizations who've been trying for so long. And I think it's a collective effort that has happened. And now it has borne fruit and Nagaland has banned it. But also now the implementation part is very necessary. If it is not implemented properly with a strong hand, then again the same things might happen. So it's implementation that needs to happen on ground now.
Right. So when you involve yourself in something like this, you know, against the dog meat trade, or when it was the transportation of elephants, like you said, you know, you went and you decided to make it your cause. So sometimes do you face powerful adversaries, and sometimes do you end up making enemies? Is it absolutely a difficult profession that requires a lot of bravery? Because what I would think.
Yes, and it does happen. We did face it in not too many ways, but we did face it. there were statements made from influential people that do not ruffle too many feathers. And then, of course, dog meat trade is a huge business. I think the money goes to a lot of different places that comes from it. And not just that, I think it also happens that influential people from those parts would try to influence because they want to also appease their own muscles. You know what I mean?
It'd be heartening to know that, you know, the police and so many members of civil society and, of course, PETA, they did support you. And did I also see a picture of John Abraham with the Purpose Foundation? How did that happen? Yes. Did he decide to come out and support you too?
Yes, this was, you know, the whole thing of Purpose launch happened during the same time when the NBA, you know, I think he's a owner of one of these teams.
Right. I think he's a great football aficionado and probably he was into and owned the team perhaps.
He owns a team, yes. So he owns a team. I'm very bad at all this, so I don't remember the name of this team.
Unfortunately, I'm equally bad and I'm not able to help you there.
But I know it is not his something. So he's the main person, he's the owner. And so he was here. There was a game that was happening. And he was here, he was at Radisson, and one of my very dear friends, and she's also part of the board of Purpose Foundation, Radha Bora Banesar. So she happened to know John from college times. So they were friends. And so when we thought that, okay, we need a face to kind of, you know, support our cause, somebody who's well known, who's a celebrity, who people will look up to, you know. And then she told me that, okay, I know this person, John Abraham, and he's here. By chance, he's here for the team. And why don't we talk to him and see if he would want to, you know, come and support us for this cause. And so we had a word with him, and it was amazing. I mean, he just said, oh, why not? You know, anything for the animals. And he has himself 3 Indian dogs, which he has as pets. So he loves indie dogs. And he completely believes in the cause. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So he said, I will be there. I will support you for the launch. And mm-hmm. And I hope that you'll do good hereafter. And so that is when he said, he agreed to come and he launched our Purpose Foundation. Yeah, and we were very lucky actually to have him and to, you know, advocate for animal rights mm-hmm. and somebody as big a celebrity as him.
Right.
I think, yeah.
And it's wonderful when you see these hunks, you know, these tall, muscular men, daunting looking sometimes, but with a very soft heart. I think it's amazing. So yes. I'm sure he will have a lot more fans when, you know, they come to know that he's also such an animal lover and has 3 indie dogs, yeah. Apart from, of course, all other reasons yeah. why he's considered so adorable. And yes. That's really
also
lovely.
A very good human being. Yes, yes. Very good human being as well. Mm-hmm. Very down to earth. And because he loves Indian dogs, we all actually love him more. You know, any celebrity who loves Indian dogs and works for Indian dogs, I think they get our vote for sure.
So I've seen Nandini, you know, in an image where you have rescued this dog and perhaps the dog is paralyzed and is in a dog cart. So where do you get these carts? Are there places that manufacture them? And is it easy to get hold of one for someone who might need it for their cat or their dog?
Yes. Now it has become a little more easier to source these carts. For paralyzed animals, but initially it was not so easy. So my first cart for Mustard, when I got it from Canine Cars, which is in California. So I had ordered in California, they had customized it there and they sent it to me. So this was this very long haul, and it's something that everybody, and it's expensive, and you know, it's not feasible in the long run. It is not you know, people will not be able to afford it. So we needed locally made wheelchairs for and readily available. So there are these certain companies that are making them. A lot of vets have actually started making them in Chennai, in Bangalore, also in Calcutta, Delhi, Bombay. So I know this. There's this place called Innovations in Delhi. So they make these carts. And locally also, these the carts which you saw, they were made locally here by two very young entrepreneurs. So they've just assembled the whole thing. And all the carts has to be customized. Every dog will have a separate measurement. So according to the measurement. So the process is ideally they come, they take the measurement. Then they go back, they assemble the parts. They would get the wheels from somewhere, the pipes from somewhere, the belts from somewhere. And they would assemble everything and get it done. So yeah, nowadays there are quite a few people who are doing it.
What you said, Nandini. And when you speak of two young entrepreneurs in Guwahati, in Assam itself, you know, who are building these carts. So let's just hope more and more of that happens all over India. And it's taken very seriously, the sufferings of animals. But coming to the lockdown again, you know, it's a very tough time for humans. So animals would really be relegated to the background. Do you think animals are suffering even more during this lockdown period? Because we ourselves are depressed and, you know, trying to find a way out of this situation. Do you see cases of more neglect towards animals during this phase?
Yes. There are two things that are happening. One is because of the lockdown, all the restaurants, all these small shops, everything is closed. There is no movement. There are no humans on the street. There's no food. There's no leftovers. There's no garbage. There's nothing. So most of the street animals are starving. So street dogs in India survive on what we throw on the road. What leftovers a small restaurant or a small shop would put on the road. You know, so they survive on, it's very important for their survival. But believe me, they were starving. And but of course, there were guidelines that were given. Though there was not proper planning. Because of no proper planning, it was very difficult for certain NGOs who were feeding these animals. They took special passes and feeder passes and used those feeder passes to go and feed the street animals. To make that kind of food, to kind of go here and there, it is a little difficult. It's kind of structurally not possible. And also, it was still better in the first lockdown. And the second half of the lockdown now, you know, at present, it's becoming even more difficult because apparently the lockdown is very serious. And they are not allowing any feeders to go out. They're not giving out any passes. So it's becoming very difficult for people to go out and feed. And which is definitely resulting in dog starving. And it is something that should not have happened. I think it's a sheer case of neglect.
Right. And it's something that probably not too many of us are giving thought to. The fact that these dogs were totally dependent on food. Discarded by people from restaurants or, you know, just thrown on the streets. So these dogs are actually starving during the lockdown because of the closure of all the restaurants.
Absolutely. Where will they get food? You know? And this is the first thing. And the second thing is there are a lot of people who are kind of having a lot many issues, you know. So there are good people, there are bad people, right? And whether it's good or bad, everybody is having issues nowadays with the whole situation. And because of that, we've seen a rise in cases of abandoned dogs. Now people either don't want to take the responsibility, they probably see them as a liability, or they don't want to spend that kind of money because money has become a problem. You know, earnings have stopped. There are different reasons, various reasons. And because of that, abandoned animals is every nook and corner. And every organization is at it. Everybody's doing whatever they can. I personally have, I think, rescued 8 of them this lockdown. The first and the second together.
8 just during these two, pet owner abandons their pet because then I think in that case, the pet is also not used to foraging for food by himself or herself. It's probably a more challenging situation for such a dog or a cat.
Yeah, it's almost impossible for them to thrive on the street.
Right.
I mean, there's no food, there's no water, there's no food, there's no safety, there's no shelter, and most, and then, you know, there are street dogs who would not accept them. It's also a huge issue. You know, okay. The area dogs, the community dogs, the community street dogs. So they will not welcome the dog very, very easily. You know, there could be fights. There could be n number of things.
So they would have to fight their way through, and they're not used to that. All of these dogs and other animals that are in your shelters, apart from that, how many animals do you have with you at home as your pets? Because since you rescue so many, and sometimes perhaps you are not even able to accommodate them in your shelter. So yeah. What happens in that case? Do you end up bringing them home?
Yes, that happens. So I have about 5 dogs with me and about 35 cats. So totally about 40 of them. Yeah.
So you're saying that you have 35 cats, if I'm not mistaken, and 5 dogs living with you in your house.
Yes, that's correct.
That's absolutely crazy, Nandini. How do you manage that? You know, it's a scenario I just cannot imagine.
Yes, it has happened. I mean, it took time for all of us to settle in. You know, I mean, some of them just don't want to go. So what do I do? They're like, no, we don't want to go.
Stories about each of them, you know, so many stories that you narrated just today, and all have their, and it's just, you know, really heartbreaking to see so much wanton cruelty by human beings. It's rampant everywhere. How do you think people can be more sensitized? Even little children are not taught to be kind to animals. Where do you think it can start, Nandini? How can we, you know, make it more widespread, this loving and caring for animals?
Yes. So this thing should start ideally from schools. You know, so education, book education, and education which is real education. For example, when you teach a child to be compassionate, when you teach a child that, you know, how to respect the space of an animal, how to respect, give love to an animal and not hurt an animal. So these are things, and there should be, you know, instead of zoos, there should be petting sanctuaries. I would advocate that. Nobody learns anything from a zoo. A zoo is a place where you cage an animal, where you take away the animal's freedom.
Right.
No,
so that's a unique thing. Nandini, I haven't heard this term before, a petting sanctuary. What is it that you have in mind? What do you visualize when you say that?
A lot of animals, happy animals running around free. And, you know, we have children coming in with their guardians, with their parents, and they spend time, they have their little picnic lunches, they can pet these little goats that run around, the little piglets that are running around, the chickens and the dogs and the cats and the squirrels. They could spend time with them, they could have this one-on-one kind of an interaction with them, start to know that these are animals that can be friends and not food. You know, so or objects of abuse. So I think a petting sanctuary is a much more healthier version of a zoo.
Like you said, in a zoo they're just caged.
Annually, even they have 2 seasons annually. Lakme Fashion Week has 2 seasons annually. So the 2017 spring summer 2017, that edition I was a part of it.
Okay. So what was what was your special contribution? What was different when you hosted it?
Right. So when I wanted to showcase my collection, I also wanted to showcase my roots, where I come from, and so. Also, at the same time, you know, I wanted to showcase what I believe in, you know, so it has to be an amalgamation of both. And because of which I made a collection out of Eri, which is one silk that is nonviolent.
It's also known as Ahimsa silk, if you know. Eri is also known as Ahimsa silk.
That's a very unique concept. Silk, that is.
Yes.
Much details, Nandini. You know, rescuing animals is one thing, but even think of silkworms. Not killing silkworms, not many would even think of them. But I think that this is amazing, this whole concept of Ahimsa silk. And yeah. Is it, would you say it's as good as any other silk?
It is beautiful. I mean, it's a beautiful silk. It has a lot of properties. It is Eri is actually very cool in summers, and it's quite warm in winters. It varies its weight according to the fiber consistency. So also Eri is a very versatile fiber which we can use with a lot of other fibers. So what I did was in my collection, which is called Bhumi Sattva, from the earth. That means from the earth. So I fused Eri with other plant-based fibers like pineapple, bamboo, and linen. So these are all plant-based fibers. And Eri being a silk, it also gave this little smooth kind of a feel to the fabric, and different very interesting textures that came out of it. So my collection basically had these very easy breezy kind of garments. It has these kaftans, loose pants, and I also do a lot of jackets. So you know, you could see a lot of jackets in my collection. Saris, which is, you know, one of my favorite. A sari is a very favorite garment of mine. So I would not want to showcase a collection without a couple of saris. So there were saris. I also did a Assamese lehenga with the traditional Eri, with the traditional motifs, but it was a lehenga. And mekhela sador as well was there, as you know, with a little bit of a twist. So basically it was a whole collection. Anybody could pick up something.
Viewers who are tuned in right now, who are watching this, what would you like them to carry forward?
Yeah, as an animal rights activist, as I've said, I've rescued so many street dogs, Indian pariah dogs, and I have realized that they are extremely good companion animals, and they are low maintenance. They have the best friendly behavior, best nature, and you know, like I said, they are very low maintenance. So it is very easy to adopt an indie dog. And my message would be to everybody should come and forward and adopt an indie dog. It's very, very important that our pariah local street dogs get adopted so that they are off the streets, and a street dog also gets a home.